Hi everyone, it's Tara Bianca with Be Light Transformative Therapy. And today I want to give you a simple exercise for improving your exhale. I hope you're going to love it. Before we jump in, I want to ask that if you get value out of my content, please subscribe, like, comment, and share. Also, if you'd like to find out about more ways to learn with me, please check out my totally free Breath Basics 6-Day Challenge, my deep dive into functional breathing called the 4-Week Breath Bootcamp, my private online Be Light community, my YouTube subscribers get a free 30-day trial, by the way, and my free functional breathing PDF. You can find all of those links at the top of the video description, so be sure to check them out. In the breathing world, we often say that the quality of your exhalation helps to determine the quality of your inhalation. Why? Because if your ribs remain flared, your spine remains rigid, and your diaphragm never really fully ascends back into its resting dome shape, how are you ever going to get a full inhale on your next breath? So I'm New York City based, right? And the analogy that comes to mind here is that when you're riding on the subway and you get to your stop, it's always the best practice to allow all passengers to exit the train first before allowing any new passengers to enter the train, right? Otherwise, it's completely inefficient and it creates total chaos. It seems obvious, but you would be amazed at the number of us who cannot learn this simple lesson. This analogy is not perfect, but I think it offers a nice visual that the quality of the outpouring really helps to determine the quality of the inpouring. Today, I want to do the exercise with you first, and then we can talk a little bit more about why this is important. This exercise that I'm about to share with you is super simple. Is it the end-all and be-all for fixing this issue? Of course not, but I think it's a really nice starting point. Okay, so in order to do this exercise, you're going to want to take either a seated or a standing position, and you're going to want to use your hands like this to monitor your breathing at your rib cage, just like we talked about in last week's video. And if you missed that, I'll have a link for you to go check it out. So I'm using my hands to offer a little bit of resistance to the rib cage. This gives me some good biofeedback so that my brain and my body get a better sense of where to breathe, a better sense of where to put their exertion. So I monitor at the lower ribs, and I'm giving a little bit of gentle inward pressure on the rib cage, offering some resistance so that when I go to breathe in, my ribs have something to push into. Okay, so how are we going to do this exercise then? We're going to breathe in through the nose with the lips gently closed, and we're going to feel that our rib cage is gently pushing the hands out to the side, like this. And we're going to fill up substantially, so it's a nice, hearty inhale. Not loud, not big, not activating the upper shoulders, but really expanding the ribcage on that inhale. And then on the exhale, we're going to use our hands with a little bit of inward pressure to gently guide the ribs in and down, like this. But it's still a passive, quiet exhale. I'm not using any effort to let go of my breath. I'm just allowing it to gently and quietly leave my body, exhaling through the nose with the lips closed. This resting point at the end of the passive exhale is what we call functional residual capacity, meaning I've exhaled, but there's still a good amount of air left in my lungs. So now, to end this simple exercise, we're going to try to blow out the rest of that air. And the goal in doing so is to get this diaphragm muscle, which is contained within the rib cage, to really fully ascend back into the chest cavity, back into its resting domed position, completing the exhale so that when we go to take our next inhale, we can get better, fuller movement of the diaphragm. Okay, but I forgot to give you a key piece. How are we going to go from a functional residual capacity at the end of our passive exhale to fully exhaling? Well, we're going to bring back an exercise that we've done many, many moons ago, which is to hum. We are going to hum the rest of the air out of our body. The humming is great because it gives you an auditory cue to really realize, like, whoa, I still had a lot more air left in my system to blow out. And it's also going to allow us to really blow off the rest of that air so that we can get that nice diaphragmatic ascension. So let me talk you through it once, and then we'll do it a few times together without any talking. So you're going to inhale through your nose with your lips closed. I'm giving some gentle pressure to my lower ribs as I inhale. My ribs push my hands out. Then I'm going to passively exhale quietly, effortlessly. My hands are going to just guide my ribs in gently. So there I am. I'm at my functional residual capacity, but there's still more air left in my lungs. So now how am I going to get it out? I've been talking too much, so let me go back to the beginning. Inhale. Exhale. So notice that as I'm exhaling from functional residual capacity to, I can't do it without the hum, notice that my hands continue to keep guiding the ribs in and down. And in doing so, we're trying to dome the diaphragm up even more. Okay, so here we go. No talking. Let's do four of these together. Inhale, exhale, hum. Four times. Easy, right? Let me know in the comments how that exercise felt for you. Why is this so important? This area between the resting position of your diaphragm after a passive exhalation, meaning domed up into the chest cavity, and the lowest ribs is referred to as the zone of apposition. During rest or quiet breathing, you'll typically get about 2 to 3 centimeters of movement on your inhale, meaning the diaphragm starts to flatten out a little bit and also descend toward the abdominal cavity. Why is the zone of apposition so important, meaning the amount of movement of the diaphragm? Because it influences the generation of intra-abdominal pressure. This is the increased abdominal pressure created as the diaphragm contracts and descends into the abdominal cavity, sort of smooshing the organs. And why is the generation of intra-abdominal pressure so important? Because this is a key feature in spinal stabilization, balance, and coordinated movement. A fully moving diaphragm assists with more functional movement and with less chance of injury. You're definitely not going to be able to measure your zone of apposition alone at home. It's best to work with a diaphragmatic specialist on this. But what's one indicator that you're doing a decently good job of generating intra-abdominal pressure? Well, we already spoke about it today, and we also spoke about it in last week's video. You're going to see your ribs flare out to the sides laterally on your inhale. And you're going to see them return back toward midline on your exhale. I've included the link for last week's video in the video description in case you missed it and you want to get a clearer explanation. And I know I don't even have to say this because you guys already know my position on this topic, but nose breathing all day, as much as possible, is also going to assist with this movement. Remember, nose breathing is more connected to full, deep diaphragmatic breathing than mouth breathing. I hope you guys enjoyed that exercise and that you'll try it out on your own. If you do try it out, please let me know your thoughts on it by dropping a comment below this video. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up and please subscribe to my channel. Also, remember to check out my totally free Breath Basics 6-Day Challenge, my 4-week breath bootcamp, my private online Be Light community, and my free functional breathing PDF. And if you'd like to donate to my channel, please visit my Buy Me a Coffee page. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.